Simon & Schuster Audio presents Catherine, the Princess of Wales, a biography of the future queen by Robert Jobson. Read by Lucy Scott.
There is no rule book, no right or wrong. You just have to make it up and do the very best you can to care for your family. Catherine, the Princess of Wales, from a speech about being a mother at the Royal College of Obstetricians and Gynecologists, 23rd of March, 2017. Preface. For everyone facing this disease, in whatever form, please do not lose faith or hope. You are not alone. Catherine, the Princess of Wales. Thursday, the 22nd of March 2024, 6 p.m. BBC News at 6 with Sophie Raworth. The Princess of Wales has just announced that she is undergoing treatment for cancer. Here now is a very personal message from her, which has just been released, in which she explains what has been happening in recent weeks. I wanted to take this opportunity to say thank you personally for all the wonderful messages of support and for your understanding whilst I have been recovering from surgery. It has been an incredibly tough couple of months for our entire family, but I've had a fantastic medical team who have taken great care of me, for which I am so grateful. In January, I underwent major abdominal surgery in London, and at the time, it was thought that my condition was non-cancerous. The surgery was successful. However, tests after the operation found cancer had been present. My medical team therefore advised that I should undergo a course of preventative chemotherapy, and I am now in the early stages of that treatment. This, of course, came as a huge shock, and William and I have been doing everything we can to process and manage this privately for the sake of our young family. As you can imagine, this has taken time. It has taken me time to recover from major surgery in order to start my treatment. But most importantly, it has taken us time to explain everything to George, Charlotte, and Louis in a way that is appropriate for them, and to reassure them that I am going to be okay. As I have said to them, I am well and getting stronger every day by focusing on the things that will help me heal in my mind, body, and spirits. Having William by my side is a great source of comfort and reassurance too, as is the love, support, and kindness that has been shown by so many of you. It means so much to us both. We hope that you will understand that, as a family, we now need some time, space, and privacy while I complete my treatment. My work has always brought me a deep sense of joy, and I look forward to being back when I am able. But for now, I must focus on making a full recovery. At this time, I am also thinking of all those whose lives have been affected by cancer. For everyone facing this disease, in whatever form, please do not lose faith or hope. You are not alone. After weeks of speculation, this is how a shocked nation learned that Catherine, the Princess of Wales, was having treatment for cancer. In her televised address, the future queen appeared resolute, a testament to her courage, not in the absence of fear, but in the face of it. The world watched as the princess spoke of her concern for her family, some on their phones or TV screens, others at Canada Gate next to Buckingham Palace, where television crews had gathered to report the breaking news live. In a video filmed by a BBC cameraman 2 days earlier in Windsor, Catherine sat alone on a bench, surrounded by daffodils and spring blossom, wearing a black and white crew neck sweater and with minimal makeup, as she revealed that she had started a course of preventative chemotherapy. The next day, the British newspapers spoke of the princess's courage and the cruel indifference of fate, reminding us all of the human frailty beneath the crowns and titles. The Times ran an editorial entitled "Catherine's Courage," commenting that the Princess of Wales deserves compassion and privacy as she recovers from cancer. It went on, The news, which was calmly delivered to the public by the princess herself in a brief video, is a chastening reminder of Cancer's capriciousness in striking without regard for age, rank, or circumstance. Following so closely on from King Charles's disclosure of his own cancer diagnosis last month, no one should now begrudge the royal family the privacy and consideration that are their due at this doubly challenging time. The Sun ran with similar words for its own editorial, with the paper writing, "Our hearts go out to Kate, as well as to William, to George, Charlotte, Louis, and to the rest of her wider family." Messages of support for the princess flooded in following the announcement. The British Prime Minister, Rishi Sunak, was among the first to react to the news. "The Princess of Wales will have the love and support of the whole of the country as she continues her recovery," he said. "She has shown tremendous bravery with her statement today." Sir Keir Starmer, the leader of the Labour Party, stated, "Any cancer diagnosis is shocking, but I can only imagine the added stress of receiving that news amidst the lurid speculation we've seen in recent weeks." President Joe Biden issued a heartfelt statement too. "Jill and I join millions around the world in praying for your full recovery, Princess Kate." His wife, Dr. Jill Biden, tweeted simply, "You are brave, and we love you. Jill." Catherine's retreat from the public eye and the tumult it stirred laid bare her foundational role within the royal family. The news of her hospital stay captured global attention, with the revelation that she planned to return to royal responsibilities post-Easter, sparking a wildfire of conjecture about her health and the solidity of her marriage. The palace's call for privacy amidst this storm of speculation only highlighted the intensity of the public's fascination and concern. The retraction of a Mother's Day photo due to digital tampering and Catherine's subsequent apology added even more layers to the unfolding drama. The blaze of conjecture intensified with news of an attempted breach into her medical records at the London clinic, reaching its zenith with Catherine's valiant video declaration. Her dignified announcement cut through the maelstrom of rumours with the truth. Social media and certain mainstream media segments seemed to corner the princess in their frenzy. But the aftermath of her video was profound, prompting apologies from those who had taken her circumstances lightly. Stephen Colbert, host of the CBS TV programme The Late Show with Stephen Colbert, expressed his regret over comments when he had poked fun at the princess and the rumours. On his show, Colbert reflected on the nature of his job, acknowledging the fine line between comedy and sensitivity. In Catherine's vulnerability, a collective strength and compassion emerged, uniting the nation and beyond in hope and solidarity with her, William, and their family. Introduction. When Kate Middleton was a child, becoming a princess would have been seen as very unlikely. It was a position reserved for foreign royals or the daughters of nobility, aristocrats like Lady Diana Spencer, who wed Prince Charles 5 months before Catherine was born. This century, though, the perception of monarchy at home and overseas has undergone a seismic transformation. Princely marriages, once a brilliant addition of a universal fact and, as such, it rivets mankind, according to the Victorian writer Walter Bagehot, are no longer restricted to unions between a certain class. In May 2004, Australian-born commoner Mary Donaldson, of Scottish parentage, married Danish Crown Prince Frederick in a ceremony attended by dozens of royals and dignitaries from around the world at Our Lady's Church in downtown Copenhagen. The prince met the student from Tasmania during the 2000 Olympics in Sydney when he stopped in at the slip-in bar where she was working. As the new King Frederick X's wife, she became Queen Mary of Denmark on the 14th of January 2024, after the unexpected abdication of Queen Margareta II, then Europe's longest reigning living monarch after 52 years on the throne. In neighbouring Norway, the marriage in August 2001 of Crown Prince Haakon, the heir apparent to the Norwegian throne, to a commoner who became Crown Prince Mette Marit was rather more controversial. The royal bride, previously known as Metamerit Jessam Hoby, was a former waitress and a single mother to her then 4-year-old son. She met the prince through mutual friends in 1999, and they announced their engagement in December 2000. They lived together until their wedding took place 8 months later, which was also considered to be controversial. The princess spoke openly about living a wild life in her past and asked the media to give her a fresh start. Then it was Britain's turn. At the University of St. Andrews in 2001, art history undergraduate Kate Middleton became reacquainted with and later fell in love with her future husband, Prince William, heir apparent to the British throne. They had known of each other from school days when they were both at private schools, he at Eton and she at Marlborough. There was plenty of socialising back then, and they were known to each other, a senior source close to the family said. They too broke with tradition and enjoyed a long courtship and lived together before they wed on the 29th of April 2011 in Westminster Abbey. Throughout British and European history, royal marriages have been used by monarchs and governments alike as a useful tool to secure strategic alliances. They were often unions arranged for political reasons and signed off while those involved were still minors and even very small children. Betrothals by proxy were commonplace throughout the courts of Europe in medieval times and later. Love between the two participants, if it developed at all, was seen as an unexpected bonus and certainly not a necessity. Often the feelings of the individuals were totally disregarded, leading to mismatches and sadness for those trapped in such unions. Others simply made the best of the situation. It perhaps explains why so many princes had mistresses and their wives enjoyed secret illicit affairs. It was largely accepted as part of the arrangement. All parties were expected to be discreet and not to upset the status quo. In British nobility terms, a commoner refers to somebody who does not hold a hereditary title or belong to the nobility, essentially a person who is not part of the aristocratic family or the peerage system. For centuries, it was seen as unacceptable for royalty in the UK or in Europe to marry commoners. Therefore, such marriages, usually born out of love, were rare and frowned upon in society when they did happen. Called morganatic marriages, these unions came loaded with legally binding caveats, the most draconian being that the spouse or any children from the union were prevented by law from inheriting royal rank, status, or privileges. At the dawn of the 20th century, however, the political tide and social landscape was turning. The First World War practically ended the power game of royal matchmaking, as practiced by Queen Victoria. After all, she had enjoyed her role as Europe's matriarch and the power it afforded her and her country in the latter third of the 19th century. As the end of her long reign approached, she had more than 30 grandchildren, and their marriages, many of which she had influenced personally, had helped to retain Britain's global influence. Victoria's death in 1901 marked the end of such meddling marriage diplomacy. Her successor, Edward VII, was more focused on diplomatic treaties such as the Entente Cordiale in 1904, in which he played a key role and helped to end antagonisms between Britain and France. It later paved the way for their diplomatic cooperation against German pressures in the decade preceding the First World War. Before Britain entered the war on the 28th of July 1914, there were well over 20 countries across Europe governed by a monarchy, with a king or queen or a regal figure of equivalent stature at its head of state. After the war, in which more than 9 million of the 60 million combat troops were killed, those returning home from the trenches and those at home who had lost loved ones demanded radical political change. Monarchies toppled like dominoes, with four great empires collapsing: the Russian Empire in 1917, the German and the Austro-Hungarian in 1918, and the Ottoman in 1922. Independent republics were formed in Austria, Czechoslovakia.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.